Sure, follow that. This is a beautiful facility. There's a lot of very talented young people walking around here. I just passed one of them in the hall, and they said, "Who represents you?" And I said, "AARP." It's no joke. I've reached that age where I can live without sex, but not without my glasses. Auditions test your faith. They test your spirit. They test your will. And sometimes you look back and you see moments where they're sort of seminal in your life. As an actor, you go through periods where the phone doesn't ring forever, and then sometimes the heavens open up and things come together. You just never know. There was a time early in my career where I auditioned for three shows in the same week. The Broadway company of La Cage aux Folles, which was the biggest hit on Broadway then, and the Broadway revival of The King and I, which was coming in with Yul Brynner, and an off-Broadway production of Pacific Overtures, the Stephen Sondheim musical about feudal Japan. It was a very exciting week for me. I auditioned for these three shows, and I had callbacks for all three. And the final one was for the callback for The King and I, and I went to an apartment up on the west side. If you don't know New York, at the base of the park at 58th Street, there are really expensive apartments that look right up the park. And they always say, if you go to an actor's apartment, you see pictures of the actor. If you go to a producer's apartment, you see Chagall's and Van Gogh's and Picasso's. This was a producer's apartment. And I came in, and when you're nervous for an audition, you bring kind of a lifeline with you. You bring your accompanist. That way you can rehearse with that person, and you kind of have a friend there. So I walked in with my accompanist, and we walked in, and they said, "You, out," and they threw him out. So now I'm alone with the producer and the casting director and the musical director, the choreographer. And we're waiting, and suddenly the door opens up, and I turn, and there is Yul Brynner. Now, for those of you who may not have met Yul Brynner, he was an alien. I mean, he was like no one else you'll ever see on this planet. He was kind of built like a bricklayer. He's much bigger than you would have thought, and he had this enormous head. And they said, "Mr. Brynner, this is Kevin Gray," and I reached my hand out, and he crushed it in his. And then he walked over to this chair. Now, the apartment had, you know, the sort of 70s, you know, shag carpet 6 inches high and the low Jetsons furniture, you know. So he went to turn the chair around. He wasn't well, you could tell. And he was kind of struggling with it. So I stepped forward to help him. And as I stepped forward, I heard the whole room go, So I froze. And then I tried to recover. You know, it was horrible. And we just waited, and then it took seemingly forever. And he finally turned the chair around and sat down. And he was just from me to you. And I was so scared, I thought, I'll look at him. And I didn't know where else to look. I was just completely, you know, freaking out. And I heard the music start to play. It was the beautiful song from the second act, I Have Dreamed, and I just didn't know where else to look. I thought I was so self-conscious. I thought, if I look away, I'll just explode. So I just looked at me and went, I have dreamed that your arms are lovely. I have dreamed what a joy you will be. You know, and it was one of those days, though, where everything was kind of going my way, and I felt like I was in good voice, and so I sort of thought, well, you know, I'll get to the bridge. It's so beautiful, and I thought, I'll give it a little extra cheese, you know, not just the regular cheese, but the extra cheese, and kind of hold the note out. I went, in these dreams I've loved you so that by now I think I know what it's like to be loved by you. I will love, and right then, I remembered that I hadn't taken a breath since I'd left my apartment 2 hours ago. So I looked at Yul Brynner and I went, I will love England by And there was this horrible freeze in the room and nobody moved. And I thought the silence would last forever. And so I said, would you like to hear the other song? And he looked at me and he said, that won't be necessary. So I ran to the door, and it was one of those New York apartments, you know, there was 18 locks on the door. It's like, I couldn't get out. Finally, the producer walked over and opened it, and I raced downstairs. I ran to a payphone. I threw some money in, and I called my agent. I said, oh my God, I've just crashed and burned in front of Yul Brynner. My career is over. And he said, well, you must have done something right, because they've offered it to you. And he said, and by the way, they've also offered you Lacazio Fall and Pacific Overtures. So you better get in here. They're talking about you at Joe Allen's, and we don't know who you are. So I raced down to my agent's office, and he asked me which one I wanted to do. And, well, I chose among the highest-paying contract on Broadway, the next highest-paying contract, and a little tiny off-Broadway contract. I picked the Sondheim show. And my agent said, well, okay, roll the dice and hope the Times likes you. And in an act of faith, I did. And they did. And that was the beginning of the journey that's brought me here. So, acts of faith.
No man nor madness, though their sad power may prevail, can possess, conquer my country's heart. They rise to fail. She's eternal, long before nations' lines were drawn, when no flags flew, when no army stood, my land was born. And you ask me why I love her through wars, death, and despair. She's the constant. We who don't care, and you wonder, will I leave her? But how? I cross over borders, but I'm still there now. Tony!